Well, good evening, everybody. How are we doing tonight? Wonderful. You know, I was reading in Judges 5:2, it's the verse says that I will sing to the Lord my God. I will make melody to the Lord, to the God of Israel. So tonight, let's sing, let's make melody to the Lord our God. So are you guys ready to worship the Lord? You guys ready to make melody to the Lord? All right, so let's bring out our worship leader, Monica, and let's worship the Lord.
Hello, everyone. I hope you're having a lovely Sunday, a lovely weekend. We are ready to sing praises to our God. And we will start with hymn number 300. It's called Grace Greater Than Our Sin. You may stand or you may be seated as you are most comfortable.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt, yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Sin and despair like the sea waves cold, threaten the soul with infinite loss. Grace that is greater, yes, grace untold, to the refuge, the mighty cross. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Dark in the stain that we what can avail to wash it away? Look, there is flowing a crimson tide, whiter than snow you may be today. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see His face, will you this moment His grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin.
Amen. And we are eternally grateful for this grace of God. We will turn to hymn number 456, How Green Are the Trees.
How green are the trees since I came to the Lord? How blue are the skies smiling over life's road? How light is my heart since its guilt rolled away? How bright is God's shining new day? I'm saved, what else can I say? No magic compares. something was new. I sought him last evening, repentance was true. And then it dawned on me what had transpired. My old sinful life had expired. I'm saved, what else can I say? No magic compares with the change in my way. I know it is real, now I see and I pray. And I wish you would come to him too.
Thank you, God. We will sing number 648, hymn 648, How Firm a Foundation.
Firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in his excellent womb. What more can he say than to you he hath said, to you who for refuge to Jesus have fled? Fear not, I am with thee, oh, be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will still give thee aid, I'll strengthen thee, help thee, and cause thee to stand, upheld by my gracious, omnipotent hand. When through the deep waters I call thee to go, the rivers of sorrow shall not overflow. For I will be with thee, thy trials to bless, and sanctify to thee thy deepest distress. When through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace, all sufficient, shall be thy supply. Thy flame shall not hurt thee, I only design thy dross to consume and thy gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus hath leaned for repose, I will not desert those his that soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never forsake.
Thank you, God, for he is faithful. You may be seated.
Thank you, Monica. You guys sounded great out there. Weren't there some great songs? Amen. All right. So, good to see you guys. Everybody having a great, really hot summer day today? Yes, huh? All right. So, did everybody receive a bulletin when they came in? And from the looks of it, I don't see anybody that looks new to Friendship of God Fellowship. So, everybody's been here before. So, let's take a look inside our bulletin. Of course, every Wednesday night, we meet for the Friendship of God Home Fellowship Bible Study, so you all are invited. Anybody that hasn't been there would like to try it out, we would love to see you. We start off at 6 o'clock. We have some food, we have some fellowship, and then we get into the Word at 6:30, and we are currently going through the book of Genesis. If you have any questions about it, you can see me, or you can see Rex and Karen, because they are hosting the study. And the Creation and Earth History Museum, of course, if you haven't been there, really want to encourage you, if you can make it out, to check out the museum, kind of go through, get a tour. Even if you want to come by and say hi and check out the bookstore and some of the stuff we have, it would be great to see you. It's just a wonderful resource for people that are searching for their origins. Where did I come from? What am I here for? Right? All that information. How does the Bible and science match up? Well, we have the answers for that at the museum. So we'd love to see you come out there. Also, if you know anybody that would like to volunteer at the museum, please give them the number here on the bulletin. Have them give us a call, and we can talk to them about that, and we can let them know what they could do there. Now, inside the bulletin, you notice an extra thing. It's the summer, so that means the summer blitz has started. I think most of you know all about the summer blitz, correct? Yes, this is the time of the year that we send out some students from Lancaster Bible College. We send them to different parts of the United States. As you see on the thing, we send some to Brooklyn, some to Miami, some to L.A., and some out to Cleveland. So this last past week, they were out there. As you can see, the overview, they went to a lot of doors. But the great news was that two Gentiles were brought to friendship with God. So that's awesome. Amen. So let's hope that we have that same next week with some Jewish people. Remember last year, we had two Jewish people come to friendship with God through that. So let's also pray for these students, because we know they are going to be under a lot of attack. The enemy is not going to be happy. So pray for their protection. Pray for their boldness. Pray that God would open up a lot of awesome doors for them to be able to share the gospel with the Jewish people there in those communities. And again, take a look at those testimonies and pray for them. Hopefully by next week, we're going to have the map that we usually have where each city, where they're at. And so this way you can get a picture of the students, their face, and what cities they're in. And you can pray for them as they go through the week. Hopefully we're going to have a great, great harvest this summer with the summer blitz. Now, one thing I also wanted to mention is regarding our parking situation here at the Vine. Next week, they are going to be putting in solar panels in the parking lot. So the parking lot's going to be closed here. But the building next door, right over there, the parking lot will be open so you can park there. And then you can walk through the breezeway to come into the Vine. Okay? I'm going to have signs out there that will show you where to go to get in here next week. So that you don't, just that you remember, and so you don't get any, why is it closed? We are going to be here. It's just they're going to be putting in some solar panels. And so just got to go back through the breezeway. Okay? So with that, that's all I have. So let's continue to worship the Lord in our giving. Back there is our donation box. If you want to give, back there we have envelopes for Friendship God Fellowship. You can put it in the envelope and stick it back there in the box, or you can just throw it in there. Also, if you need prayer after the service, come on up front. There'll be somebody to pray with you. Also, we have prayer cards back there that you can fill out and that you can drop back in the box, and we will make sure that we pray for you during the week. And so let's pray. Let's prepare our hearts for the rest of the service. Heavenly Father, we do thank you so much for your mercy and your grace, Lord. We thank you for what you're going to do, and we look forward to a great harvest this summer with the Summer Blitz. Father, we pray that you would bless those students, that you would encourage them, that you would protect them, and that you would use them mightily this summer. Father, we pray now that you would prepare our hearts for what you have to say to us tonight. Father, that you would speak to our hearts, that you would encourage us, and that you would strengthen us in our faith. And so we want to thank those that are supporting this ministry. We pray that you would bless those that are giving, bless those gifts, that they would continue to go out and we would see the gospel preached in many places and many people come to a friendship with God through that. So, Father, we give this evening to you. We give the rest of the service to you. We ask your blessing on it and all that we do. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
As you are, we're going to be singing hymn number 298, Softly and Tenderly, Jesus is Calling.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you. Waiting and watching. watching for you and for me.
And oh, what a great song that is. You know, it's so powerful that just those two words, come home. It's very powerful. Come home, he's saying. Come home, home to God, home to Christ. Wonderful, wonderful tonight, these hymns. We've been so blessed. Let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord, that we have a home to come home to. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you have gone before to build a home for us, Lord. And Lord, we thank you so much that as these summer blitzers are going out, that, Lord, they can say the same thing. There's a home for you. Come home. Come home to Christ. Lord, thank you for each one of these students who have gone out there. Mightily strengthen them tonight, Lord. Greatly encourage them, to them to know, Lord, that if God be for them, what difference does it make who's against them? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Joel. Book of Joel. Please turn to the book of Joel. Joel's been crying out from the Bible for a long time saying, what about me? What about me? Well, it's your turn, Joel. Okay, turn to the book of Joel, please. Joel chapter 1. Joel chapter 1, verse 1. The word of the Lord that came to Joel, the son of Pethuel. Hear this, ye old men, give ear, all ye inhabitants of the land. Hath this been in your days, or even in the days of your fathers? Tell ye your children of it, and let your children tell their children, and their children another generation, that which the palmer worm hath left, hath the locust eaten. That which the locust hath left, hath the canker worm eaten. That which the canker worm hath left, hath the caterpillar eaten. Awake, ye drunkards, and weep and howl, all you drinkers of wine, because of the new wine, for it is cut off from your mouth. For a nation has come up upon my land, strong and without number, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion, and he hath the cheek teeth of a great lion. He hath laid my vine waste, barked my fig tree. He hath made it clean bare, cast it away. The branches thereof are made white. Lament like a virgin girded with sackcloth for the husband of her youth. The meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests, the Lord's ministers, mourn. The field is wasted, the land mourneth, the corn is wasted, the new wine is dried up, the oil languisheth. Be ashamed, O ye husbandmen, howl, O ye vine dressers, for the wheat and for the barley, because the harvest of the field is perished. The vine is dried up, the fig tree languisheth, the pomegranate tree, the palm tree also, the apple tree, even all the trees of the field are withered, because joy is withered away from the sons of men. Gird yourselves and lament, ye priests. Howl, ye ministers of the altar. Come, lie all night in sackcloth, ye ministers of my God, for the meat offering and the drink offering is withholden from the house of your God. Sanctify ye a fast. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land into the house of the Lord your God, and cry unto the Lord. Alas, for the day of the Lord is at hand, and as a destruction from the Almighty shall it come. Is not the meat cut off before our eyes? Yea, joy and gladness from the house of our God. The seed is rotten under their clods. The garners are laid desolate. The barns are broken down. The corn is withered. How do the beasts groan? The herds of cattle are perplexed because they have no pasture. Yea, the flocks of the sheep are made desolate. O Lord, to thee will I cry, for the fire hath devoured the pastures of the wilderness, and the flame hath burned all the trees of the field. The beasts of the field cry also unto thee, for the rivers of water are dried up, and the fire hath devoured the pastures of the wilderness. Start a new book. Start a new book today. Book of Joel. Joel, great book. Joel, the meaning of the word Joel is Jehovah El. It means Jehovah is God. We read Jehovah as Jehovah Jesus. The word Joel to us means that Jehovah Jesus is God. We should all be named Joel. Oh, because a reminder that Jesus is God. As far as Joel goes in the book of Joel and what he's written to us, we don't know very much at all about this prophet. We don't know anything about him except that as he identifies himself, he says he's Joel, the son of Pethuel. I don't believe that he's told us that his father's name is, that he's the son of Pethuel, so that we'll be able to necessarily identify him. But it's significant he tells us he's the son of Pethuel because of the meaning of the word Pethuel. Pethuel means influenced by God. And so what he's really saying here is that I am Joel, I am the father of the man who was influenced by God. And Joel is influenced by God. And later on in his book, he's going to talk about the need to influence children for God. And he's saying, I am a child that was the son of a man who was influenced by God. We don't know who Pethuel is. We don't know which city Joel was in. We don't know which tribe Joel was from. We don't know if Joel had brothers and sisters, wife, filled children. We don't know anything like that. And Joel doesn't want us to know. It's purposeful, because the message of Joel's book and his life, it's not about Joel. Joel wants us to focus on, as he starts his book out in verse 1, the word of the Lord, the word of the Lord. If the people focus on Joel, Joel feels he would be a total failure, because Joel's message is not Joel. Joel's message is God and his word. And that's the way our life should be. Our life should not be about us. It should be about God and his word. And just as Joel would say, if he was here tonight, he would say, if I focused people on God, then my life is a success. If I focus people on me, then my life is a failure. And so it is with us. If we focus people on Jesus Christ, then our life is a success. And if we focus people on ourselves, always talking about ourselves, then our lives are a failure. And this was the challenge that John the Baptist had, because John the Baptist was an extremely colorful person out there dressed in camel hair and eating locusts and honey out there in the rough in the wilderness, and his preaching was fiery. And John the Baptist knew that people were coming out to him like coming to a like coming around the corner here to the Santee drive-in theater. Let's go out tonight and see John the Baptist. He's really entertaining. And this was the greatest threat that John the Baptist faced when people came out to see him. And that's why John the Baptist said about himself compared to Jesus Christ, he said in John 3:30, he must increase, but I must decrease. He didn't say, I must decrease, but he must increase. He said, he must increase, and I must decrease. In other words, he put Jesus Christ first because he said, as Jesus Christ increases, I don't want to get in the way. It's all about him. Now, Joel has given us in this first words of his book here a very important little word to tell us the source of everything that he's going to tell us here, the source of his writing. And it's a word in Joel 1:1, the word of the Lord that came to Joel. This came to Joel. He used the word to tell us that the word of the Lord came first to him, and then he's passing it on. And that's the way we should see this book. We should see this book as coming from God to Joel to us. And that's how God wants us to see the Bible, as God's word that came to the men who wrote the Bible and then to us. Because it's so easy to fall into the trap of looking at the Bible as a compilation of writings to people thousands of years ago. And if that's only how the Bible is viewed, then the value of the Bible has been lost. Because when Jesus Christ said something very, very important when he was speaking to Sadducees, who did not believe in resurrection of any kind, Sadducees who did not believe there was any afterlife, Sadducees who did not believe there was life after death, Jesus Christ, in order to straighten them out, because their problem was, as he said, you don't know the scriptures or the power of God, and so in order to straighten them out, he quoted a Bible passage which was very familiar, which was God speaking to Moses out of the burning bush. And he quoted what God said to Moses out of the burning bush. And he said this in Matthew 22:31. And by the way, he's talking, Jesus Christ at this time, talking to Sadducees, is talking about something that happened over 1,000 years before these Sadducees that he was addressing at that time. In Matthew 22:31. Jesus said, as touching the resurrection of the dead, have you not read that which was spoken unto you by God, saying, I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob? God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. Jesus Christ was quoting from Exodus 3 of what God said to Moses, as I said, over 1,000 years earlier. And yet Jesus Christ did not say, in quoting that in Matthew 22:31, he did not say, have you not read that which was spoken unto Moses by God? After a while, it was spoken to Moses by God in Exodus 3:15. God said that God was speaking to Moses. But Jesus Christ said that God spoke to you, Sadducees. And that's how we should view the Bible in every part of it. Because he said, but as touching the resurrection of the dead, have you not read that which was spoken unto you by God? And you can just imagine the Sadducees saying, what? I don't remember being there over 1,000 years ago. And Jesus Christ would say, no, but it was written to you. Written to you. And that's how we should look at the Bible, every part of the Bible. Just like the little child's hymns, little child's song goes, every promise in the book is mine. Every chapter, every verse, every line, all the blessings of his love divine, every promise in the book is mine. That's how we should look at it. All written to us. From Genesis to Revelation, every word in the Bible is spoken by God to us. And so now, first of all, Joel calls out a group of people in particular who need to hear what he's going to say. First on his list in verse 2 are old men. He says, "Hear this, ye old men, and give ear." And he says, "Give ear, give ear." And that's a scene of it's a convicting word for us, give ear, because it causes us to ask the question, what do we give our ears to? What do we give our, how much time in the day do we give our ear to listen to God, to what he has to say in the Bible? Like the hymn says, the hymn's asking a question, do you have any room for Jesus? Have you any room for Jesus, he who bore your load of sin? As he knocks and asks admission, sinner, will you let him in? Room for Jesus, King of glory, hasten now his word obey. Swing the heart's door widely open, bid him enter while you may. Room for pleasure, room for business, but for Christ the crucified, not a place he can enter in the heart for which he died. Room and time now give to Jesus. Soon will pass God's day of grace. Soon your heart left cold and silent, and the Savior's pleading cease. We just sang about that. We just sang about the limited time. And so he's saying, give ear to these old men. And he tells the old men, and now he's going into this judgment that's coming. Great judgment. Whole chapter is about a great judgment coming to Israel. And he's saying to the old men, he's saying to them in verse 3, he says, tell your children of it, and let your children tell their children and their children another generation. God is calling on the old men to tell their children, that their children should tell their children, and their children should tell their children. There is a great tragedy today in America. I think it's the greatest tragedy. The greatest tragedy that America faces today is not the tragedy of the inflation. It's not the tragedy of the growing cost of gasoline. It's not the tragedy of the economy. The greatest tragedy in America today is that we have a whole generation of people today who know nothing about Jesus Christ. That's the tragedy. Children today, from young, when they're in school, they know all about sex, but they know nothing about Jesus Christ who made them. As Glenn just said, come to the museum to find out about origins. You know, there's such an intense interest today in origins. 23andMe, Ancestry.com, who do I come from? Where's my origins? And the Bible tells the real origin of man, Jesus Christ, who made them. Children today know all about transgenders, but children know nothing about Jesus Christ, who made them both male and female. Children today know all about homosexuality and sin, but children today know nothing about Jesus Christ, who cleanses the heart and forgives from sin unto him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Children don't know anything about that. I'm so glad that the Del Mar Fair is starting up, and that the Child Evangelism is going to have their Bible booth there, and my partner Scott and I, we've already signed up for our 5 evening shifts there, and if you want to see something, you come out to that. As families walk by the front of the booth, and I yell out to them, "Hey, mom and dad, how about a Bible story for your child there?" You know, and so you know, we're on this side over there and over there, and so they come walking by, and over here they're selling puppets and photographs and jewelry or anything like that, and the people, and I'm yelling out to them, and then the families would just walk farther and farther away from me and over there, and I went over to those businesses over there. I said, "You need to give me a commission. I push customers into your place." and then at the end of which, but we have a great time. Oh, the children, a whole generation of children know nothing about Jesus Christ. What a joy it is to sit there and in the little chairs the children sit in front of, and just to go through that wordless book and to say, heaven, really, you can go to heaven, that gold color. But there's a huge problem. This is the big problem. Have you ever told a lie? And I've told you the story about the little sister and the brother that came in, and I looked at that sister, and I said, "Have you ever told a lie?" And she gets all screwed up. She said, "He has." Children are so great. But black was sin. Black was sin. And black, and then the red, the blood of Christ. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. And then the white color, and we can be white as snow, totally washed from our sins, and then go to heaven. And then the green color. Now it's your turn to grow in Christ, and it's wonderful. That's a wonderful place. You look at the Del Mar Fair there, and from heaven I can just see God's spotlight on that little old Bible castle coming down, and say, "That's my place. That's the place where children are going to learn about the Savior who loved them and died for them and wants them to come home." Yes, let's see, where in the world were we? Oh, yeah. So why is it today that children know nothing about the Lord Jesus Christ? Why is that? It's because mothers and fathers, old men also, failed to do verse 3. Verse 3, tell your children of it. Let your children tell their children and their children another generation. So that's why we have a whole generation out there of children that are lost in the world, not knowing anything about the Savior, Jesus Christ, who loved them, died for them, and is asking them to come home. And it only took one generation of mothers and fathers and grandfathers to break the link of verse 3, tell your children of it. Your children, their children, and children of the generation. That's why I've mentioned this before. That's why I love that book, The Lamb, that we sell over in the bookstore, as Glenn was talking about tonight, the Museum of Creation and Earth History here, because it tells on a child's level the message of the Bible with beautiful illustrations. And I would to God, I would to God that every mom and dad took time to sit down with their children and let their children read that book aloud to the family, and then go around the family, let the children go around the family and ask those 14 questions at the end of every chapter. Why is it so important for children to learn the Bible? So children and adults don't repeat the same sins of others in the past. It's not necessary. God, this book is so amazing. Because the Holy Spirit of God, God the Father, takes us into this book, and we live the lives of these other people in this book. We live the pain of sin that they had. It becomes embedded in us. We get a fear of the consequences of sin from this book. Psalm 119, verse 9. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his ways? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. Why were all these things written to us? Because of 1 Corinthians 10:11, all these things happened unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world have come. It's written for us to not have to do the same mistakes and the same sins that the others did, and it's recorded in the Bible. You know, I want to learn all about the sea in Loretto, because I don't want to drive my boat over a shallow rock or a tree or go aground, and there are plenty of them. So I want to learn where all the shallow rocks are and all the obstacles are, and so I go around in my little tiny 14-foot aluminum boat. And sometimes I hit a shallow rock and I scrape it, and when that happens, it terrifies me, and I never forget it, and I don't have to make a note of where those rocks are. It's embedded in me in a fear that when I come near those areas, fear grabs me and a bad memory. The Loretto River next to Loretto empties into the sea. The Arroyo, the riverbed, empties into the sea. And during storms, there are a lot of rocks that have washed out there. There's even two trees that are under the water there. And I remember the time when I was putting along at about 10 miles an hour, and I was 500 feet off from the shore. I was 500 feet, and all of a sudden I watched the depth meter. Oh, that's interesting. It's going from pretty fast, 20 feet, 15 feet, 10 feet, 5 feet. Wait, is my eyes seeing this right? 1 foot, and on the back of the transom boat went boom, like that. exit one propeller. It literally bit the dust, only it bit the sand. And I ended up with a broken propeller. I don't need to make a note about that. I stay 1 mile out when I come to that Loretto River. Because whenever I see that Loretto River, I get afraid. And I remember, it's just like it happened just like yesterday, and I swing way out in a big wide berth because it only took that one time to make me afraid of shallow water in the boat. And now, I don't have to go and have that happen. If I have that happen all the time, I'm not going to have a boat. But instead, I study charts. I study charts. I even got charts on my phone. I got my phone. I don't know if you can probably can't even see it. Those are all danger points around Loretto. And I study them. And when I find one, I put a flag there too. Add more. And why do I do that? Because those charts do for me what I need. And that's why I study them, to be alerted by information, not by experience. This is an alert by information, not by personal experience. We know I don't need to hit every obstruction to find out where they are. I just need to be warned where they are. And that's what the Bible is. Charts that tell us where the dangers of life are. Like the hymn says, Jesus, Savior, pilot me over life's tempestuous seas. Unknown waves before me roll, hiding rock and treacherous shoal. A shoal's like a sandbar. Hiding rock and treacherous shoal. Chart and compass come from thee. Savior, Jesus, Savior, pilot me. Pilot me. Hiding rock and treacherous shoal. There's a place on the south of the island of Danzante. It's marked here. It says migrating shoals. You know what that means? That means those sandbars are moving. I give that a big wide berth. I don't want to even get near those. Now, as we go on now in the book of, in this first chapter here, we come to a description in verse 4 of this particular judgment of God. And this description here is lists four insects. They're just insects. And you just look at them alone, it doesn't look like it could cause any harm. But these four insects, even though they're different words in the King James, they're actually four varieties of the same insect, the insect, if you want to call it insect, the locust. These are four different varieties of locust. Just little itty-bitty locust. What harm could it do? Not much, if we're talking about just one locust. But the judgment is not just one locust. The judgment is a great swarm of locusts. And locust was one of the terrible judgment plagues on Egypt. Exodus 10:14, the locust went up all over the land of Egypt and rested in all the coasts of Egypt. Very grievous were they. Before them there were no such locusts as they, neither after them shall there be such. That plague of locusts over Egypt, one of the 10 plagues Moses brought in, was so terrible that it destroyed the land of Egypt. It was all over the land of Egypt. There was not a piece of land in Egypt that didn't have those locusts. There was not a stretch of sand on any beach in Egypt where there were no locusts. Those locusts covered the windows of the houses so you couldn't look out. Those locusts hugged the contour of the doors so that when the doors opened, they just swarmed into the house. Those locusts crawled under the covers of beds. They crawled under the pillows of beds. And that's what's meant in Exodus 10:14. The locust went up over all the land of Egypt and rested in all the coast. Very grievous were they. There was no place to escape from those locusts. There was no place to hide from those locusts. There was no place to crawl away from where those locusts weren't. They were everywhere. That's why the locusts are called in Exodus 10:14, very grievous they were. And it was not just that those locusts were everywhere. It was the type of locusts that they were. They were not the usual locusts that people were used to seeing. These locusts were, Exodus 10:14, before them there were no such locusts as they, neither after them shall there be such. No one ever saw locusts like that before. There were never locusts as big as those ones before. There were never locusts larger than them before. There were never locusts that there were never so many locusts in one place before. Since that plague of locusts, there has never been a large colony of locusts in one place since then. Those locusts were more voracious than any locust have been in the past, and there's never been locust so hungry as they were since then in Egypt. Those locusts ate everything in Egypt. The land of Egypt was absolutely destroyed by those locusts. Those locusts were more loud than any locusts have been in the past. There's never been locusts so loud as they were in Egypt. The sound of those locusts must have been deafening. You couldn't sleep. You must have been, you drive you out of your mind, all that sound. And if you're in bed and you rolled over, all you heard was the crunch of squashed locusts. And the sound of those locusts was like assaulting. And all because those locusts were created as a plague. They were created to torment. And they tormented the Egyptians because the Egyptians would not humble themselves and let God's people, the Jewish people, go. And it was not just for a morning that those locusts came in and blew out. It was not just for an afternoon that those locusts came and went. It was not just for a day that those locusts were in Egypt. They were there for a few days. Those locusts were special locusts which were created for one purpose, torment. And they tormented the Egyptians for a few days. That was the whole design of the Egyptian plague of locusts, was to humble the Egyptians with a little insect, the locust. And God knows how to humble with the little insect. And he was leading the Egyptians to repent and let Israel go. And this plague of locusts that Joel is describing in this first chapter, it doesn't last for a day or a few days. It lasts for 4 years. And the devastation is complete. And the whole design of this plague of locusts in verse 4 is to humble Israel with a little tiny animal, an insect. And God was leading Israel to repent of their sins. And the whole design of God with troubles that come in to a lost person's life, softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, "Oh, sinner," the whole design is to humble and to lead to repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. And with the plague of these locusts in verse 4, God shows he knows how to humble with a little tiny insect. Because God's resistance is given to the proud and God's grace is given to the humble, James 4:6. He gives more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Because God knows how to humble. He knows how to humble a person with the little tiny weakest little animal of a locust. And when a person is humbled, grace pours in and help by God pours in, which is what God told Jacob. God told Jacob, "Jacob, I want you to see yourself as a worm. I want you to see yourself as low as a worm. So low, Jacob, you could sit on a dime and swing your legs." And God called Jacob a worm, and he said, "When you see yourself as a worm, I will help you." Isaiah 41:14. "Fear not, thou worm, Jacob, and ye men of Israel, I will help thee, saith the Lord, and thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel." So God used the locust to humble as an instrument of judgment, great power of God. And it was amazing, these locusts are called out for that one amazing characteristic about them in Proverbs 30, verse 27. It says, "The locusts have no king, yet go they forth, all of them, by bands." The locusts have no ruler, no organizer, no leader, no king, but under God's command, they fly in bands with precision attacks. No kings, yet they are organized in attacking waves. No king, they fly in formation. No king, they fight with more strategy and wisdom than the bombers in World War II and Pearl Harbor. All because they've been ordered by God. So without a king, They are described as a nation in verse 6. In verse 6, for a nation is come up upon my land, strong and without number, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion, and he hath the cheek teeth of a great lion. Now, that was not just any land that got destroyed there, that those locusts came to destroy. That was God's land. That was his land of Israel. And God called it that. He said in verse 6, for a nation has come up upon my land. It's the nation of locusts that have come against his land. And God is willing to sacrifice his beautiful land of Israel just to humble the Jewish people and bring them to repentance. And these locusts in verse 6, they're like no other locusts that have ever been, because these locusts have teeth. They have teeth in verse 6, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion, and he hath the great cheek teeth of a great lion. It's the teeth of these locusts that are so terrible, the teeth torment. You know, there's another locust described in the book, in the Bible, which was created with the teeth of a lion and also to torment. And these locusts are described in the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 9, verse 3, it says, and there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of those locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads were as it were crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men, and they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions, and they had breastplates as the breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, in the Hebrew tongue, Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue, his name is Apollyon. Those locusts in Revelation 9, those locusts, they don't eat the grass, they don't touch the trees, they go after men. And they have stingers, like the stingers of a scorpion. And they don't kill, they just cause enormous pain. And they do that for 5 months. And the torment is so bad on the people, they want to die. They just want to die. Suicide. Revelation 9:6, in those days shall men seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. Life with those locusts for those lost people in Revelation is so bad they seek death. These people are lost from Jesus Christ, and life is so miserable that they just want to die. Like many lost people today, when life just gets to be so miserable, too miserable to live. Just like I was reading in the paper just this last week, where it was, this one person said life was so miserable, he said, I just so easy to want to pull the trigger. Life might be miserable because everything has gone wrong in life. Failed relationships, divorce. Failed finances, bankruptcy. Failed dreams, being fired. Failed health, in pain. Failed satisfaction, no peace. Failed legality, in prison. Any one of those reasons or other reasons, a person can just reach the end of their rope, the limit of their stamina, the maximum emotions that they can tolerate, and they just want to get out of their failed state, and death looks like it's such an easy out. Reminds me of the time when I was with my lost friend in Japan. We were talking about life and death, and he says, I'll tell you what life's like. Put a cigarette in his mouth and struck a match, lit a cigarette, held the match up, said, this is life. And then he said, this is what life like. And then he blew the match out, smoke came up. He said, that's what death's like. He said, death means you no longer exist. Like my grandfather, the rabbi, said on his deathbed, when you're dead, you're dead. So wrong. So false. When you're dead, you do not cease to exist. Everyone will be raised from the dead and hear the voice of Jesus Christ, as he said in John 5:28, marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice and shall come forth, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. These lost people in Revelation, under the misery of the scorpion-like locust, will want to die because death looks so inviting as a step out. Just a step out of the misery. Step out of the misery. Just like lost people today, who under the misery of their lives, whatever it might be, just want to die because death looks so inviting as a step out of misery. And that's all they see. All they see is the step out. And they choose death instead of life in suicide. But what they don't see is the second part. Step out to step in. Step out to step in. What they don't see is death is a step out to step into hell. What they don't see is that death is a step into hell. Step out is a step into hell, a hell of beyond the reach of any help, being in the worst loneliness possible, being in the worst prison, caged in the worst solitary confinement for eternity, being imprisoned with no due process, no attorney, no appeal, no relief, no getting out for good behavior, no getting out because the jails are overcrowded. Hell's not going to be overcrowded where people just get out. No negotiation, no plea bargain, no parole. And it doesn't matter if a person gets death by a shotgun blowing his head off, cremation that reduces him to ashes, destruction at sea, or destroyed by worms, every lost soul will be reformed to wake up in hell. And it all happens because a lost person is at war with God. A lost person is an enemy of God. And there's only one hope for a person. If he chooses life instead of death, and God's solution during life is to make peace with God. And God said in Isaiah 27:5, let him take hold of my strength that he may make peace with me, and he shall make peace with me. God's invitation was what we just sang. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. What's he calling? Make peace with me. God's invitation for the lost who are at war with God is to make peace with God by throwing himself into the hand of God. Let God strengthen. Let God strengthen to call on the name of Jesus Christ and make peace with God, because Jesus Christ, he is our peace. He's our peace. Ephesians 2:14, he is our peace. And all this judgment described here in this first chapter, it's all designed to humble. It's all designed to bring a person to say, uncle to God, I give up. You win. I want to make peace with you. Repentance, willingness to let Jesus Christ swing the heart's door widely open. And that's why God is willing to destroy even his own land, because the salvation of the lost is just that important to him. He'll sacrifice. He sacrificed his son for the salvation of souls. He'll sacrifice the land. And that's why God is willing to bring the land to the point of verse 10, the field is wasted, the land mourneth. When the land becomes like that, wasted in a state of mourning, that also breaks God's heart. Why? Because God made the land special. God made the earth special. This last week in Loretto, Rosie and Joel, who take care of the house, they brought me two tomatoes, and they had a little tomato vine there, and they said, look, we got this, and I said, la tierra produce. The ground produces. How amazing is that? How amazing is how dirt, brown, dusty dirt, can make a beautiful, delicious red tomato? How's that work? That's because God made the land to produce. From Genesis 1:11, God said, "Let the earth bring forth grass, herb yielding seed, fruit yielding fruit after its kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth," and it was so. You know, there's a beautiful statement in the Bible about this that's actually forms the part of the Jewish prayer for bread, thanking God for bread. It's from Psalm 104:14. Psalm 104:14, it says, "He causes the grass to grow for the cattle, an herb for the service of man, that he may bring forth food out of the earth." The word food is not the correct word. It's the word lechem, bread, that he may bring forth bread out of the earth. The phrase is just so astounding, and it's said every time in the Jewish prayer of for Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Motzi lechem min haaretz. Lotzi lechem min haaretz. Lotzi means bring forth, draw out. That's what lotzi means. Lechem means bread, like Bethlehem, like Bethlehem. Lechem means bread. Min means from, and haaretz means the ground. Leotzi lechem min haaretz. He brings forth bread from the earth. Literally, that's what it means. He brings forth bread from the ground. Think of it. A loaf of fresh, warm, delicious bread brought from the dirt. That's what God does. How wonderful of God to bring forth bread from the ground. That's another reason we can have confidence in Jesus Christ, who made that happen, because he brings forth bread from the earth. And so it's a great thing. I mean, when you say that prayer in Hebrew, you're reminding yourself, thank you, God, for bringing forth bread from the ground. That's what he does. Well, here we are, we're talking about the judgment of Israel here. And now he's called, as he goes on here, he's called in verse 11, God has called for two people, he says, he's calling these two people, and he's saying to these two people, be ashamed. In verse 11, be ye ashamed, O ye husbandmen, howl, O ye vine dressers, for the wheat and for the barley, because the harvest of the field is perished. Two people here are called to be ashamed and howl with shame. It's the husbandmen and the vine dressers. Why are the husbandmen and the vine dressers singled out to be ashamed? It's because of verse 11, because the harvest of the field is perished. It was the field of all those trees, the field of all those vines that the husbandmen and the vine dressers worked so hard on. Those husbandmen and those vine dressers poured their lives into those trees and into those vines. They spent their God-given lives working for the harvest. They used all their strength of their lives for that harvest. Their careers, their life work was spent in that field. They devoted their lives to that field, looking forward to the harvest. They poured all their care, all their concern into that field for the harvest. And now there is no harvest. The harvest of the field is perished, in verse 11, because the harvest of the field is perished. And as the husbandman and the vine dresser looks over the field that's destroyed and the fact that there'll be no harvest, they see that they've spent their lives for nothing. It's all destroyed. And that's just like the lost who have spent their lives trying to gain the world and they've lost their own souls. As Jesus said, what shall it profit a man if he gain the world and lose his own soul? What shall it profit a man if he gains money and he loses his soul? He gains reputation and he lost his soul. He's gained lands and a mortgage-free house and he's lost his soul. He's gained treasure on earth, and he's lost his soul. And in the end, the only thing that there is a feeling of shame for having spent lives and strength on themselves and not on God, with zero in the heavenly bank account balance. And they're left with the big, shameful question of why. I read the account one time of a man who was dying, and his brother came into him and said, "Are you afraid to die?" And he goes, "No, I'm not afraid to die. I'm ashamed to die." And as they see their bodies deteriorating into debilitation, And they realize, I'm not rich toward God. And they're ashamed and face the question, why did I do this? And all the while, God was asking the same question in Isaiah 55:2, wherefore do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. A person's life is like a limited amount of money. No matter how poor or how rich and wealth a person may be, Elon Musk and included, each person has a limited amount of life and strength. And money can't increase that. Like a limited amount of money, and a person will spend his limited amount of life and strength on what he chooses. And when God sees a person spend his limited amount of life and strength on not serving God, not laying up treasures in heaven, but instead serving himself, laying up treasures on earth, God says, why? Why are you wasting your life and strength on that which is only going to crumble away from you at the end of life? And as a person sees it all crumble away at the end of life, as health fails, and he realizes, I'm poor toward God, all that remains is verse 11, intense shame. Because eventually, as death approaches a lost person, it will be, verse 12, joy is withered away. What a statement for the end of life. Joy is withered away. As death approaches, joy of life, joie de vivre, the joy of life withers away into some distant memory. As Barbara Streisand sings, the way we were, it's scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind, smiles we gave to one another for the way we were. Can it be that it was all so simple then, or has time rewritten every line? If we had the chance to do it all over again, tell me, would we, could we? Memories may be beautiful, and yet what's too painful to remember, we simply choose to forget. We're all heading down that road. We're all heading down that road. In verse 12, joy is withered away. A state of loss for what we have on earth is slowly becoming the way we were, what we had on earth. And all that's left is the memories of the way we were, because Jesus said in Luke 12:15, a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth. As for whatever wealth or possessions we have on earth, it'll all become, verse 12, joy is withered away. So what are we supposed to do? What are we supposed to do when it happens? What are we supposed to do if we're in this state of Joel chapter 1? Habakkuk tells us in Habakkuk 3:17, although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall the fruit be in the vines, the labor of the olive tree shall fail, and the fields shall yield no meat. The flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stalls. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength, and he will make my feet like hinds' feet, and he will make me to walk upon my high places. When life becomes that state of desolation that Joel chapter 1 is talking about, when nothing goes right, that's the time when we pull out of our pockets that great yet, Habakkuk 3:18, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. It sounds so good to rejoice in God when all goes wrong, but tell me, would we, could we? When all goes wrong, would we rejoice in Christ? Could we rejoice in Christ? The answer to that question depends on what street we live on. It depends on the address of our souls. My house is located on a street called Shining Light Way. And when I turn onto my street and I see that street sign up there that says Shining Light Way, I ask myself the question, do I really live here? Do I really live on Shining Light Way, or do I live on Dark Shadow Lane? Because the answer to the question, when all goes wrong and we need to rejoice, and tell me, would we, could we? It depends on the street we live on. Where do we really live? Do we live on Sorrow Street or Joy Way? Do we live on God Dependence Way or Independence Boulevard? Do we live on Looking Up Street or Looking Down Lane? Do we live on Complain Road or Praise Avenue? Do we live on Treasures in Heaven Path or Treasures on Earth Highway? Or do we live on Shining Light Way or Extinguishing Flicker Lane? The question is, would we? Could we? It all comes down to what streets our souls live on. What is the address of our souls? Where do we really live? What's the name of the street we really live on? And if we're living on the wrong street, it's not hopeless, because there's a way to change our spiritual address. We can move to the right street and get a new address for our souls, but we can't do it by ourselves. We need help in moving. And the way to get that help to move our souls to the right street is verse 14. Verse 14, cry unto the Lord. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much, Lord, that you're there to help us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Mr. Cantor. What a beautiful word tonight, right? I think we all hear God's voice calling us. And today we're actually ending with hymn number 270, God Calling Yet. And it ends with the line that says, the voice of God hath reached my heart. So I invite you to stand and we can sing this last hymn. If you prefer to stand, or you may stay seated.
God calling, yet shall I not hear. Earth's pleasure shall I still hold dear. Shall life's good passing years all fly, and still my soul in slumber lie. God calling, yet shall I not rise. Can I his loving voice despise, and baseless guilt my fear repay? He calls me still, can I delay? God calling, yet when shall he knock? And I my heart the closer lock. He still is waiting to receive, and shall I dare his spirit breathe? God calling, yet I cannot say. My heart I yield without delay. Vain world farewell, from thee I part. The voice of God hath reached my heart.
Have a good night, everyone. We'll see you next week.